Umi Perkins, a known scholar and teacher in our community.
It seems strange to me that I'd be speaking about a topic as seemingly secular and sovereignty in this space. And then it occurred to me that reconciliation is not necessarily secular at all. And that's the topic of my talk here. The reconciliation is about consciousness. About a new consciousness. Well, it's not really new at all. In fact, it might be the oldest thing in the world. But as Eckhart Tolle says, broken in the name of a second-hand shop, new you. Maybe not new people in this room, but new to the vast majority of people in the world. I really have 3 points that I want to bring up today. The first one, I want to begin with a short story. It comes from Australia, a place where they've had a lot of challenges and done a lot of work on reconciliation. In the Northern Territories...
Excuse me. Can you folks hear? Can you just go up on that one?
In the Northern Territories of Australia, there is an elder named David Wurrubrunner. And at one point, oil was discovered on the land of that group of Aborigines. And they had to decide whether they were going to have a profit sharing with the oil company. Now, in Aboriginal culture, an important part of the culture is called dreaming. In fact, this story was told to me by Dr. Ian McIntosh, who is the director of cultural survival, where I used to work. He was a mentor of mine. In fact, he wrote a book called Aboriginal Reconciliation and the Dreaming. So David Wurrubrunner said that he would sleep on it, or dream on it. And so that night he had a dream where he was walking on the land, and he saw a hole in the ground. And as he looked into the hole, he saw the largest nugget of gold imaginable. He could barely lift it. And so he reached down, and as he was lifting it, he thought to himself, all this can be ours. All the wealth of the world. And just as he was thinking that, everything that he was, his identity, his community, drained into that hole. And so the next day, the elders of that council decided not to allow oil drilling on their land based on that dream. The reason I tell this story is it suggests that reconciliation is about being open to other ideas, open to other ways of thinking, other logics. Reconciliation in a way is like democracy, as they, some people say, agonizing, beautiful democracy. It can be very painful. As Carl Jung said, there's no coming to consciousness without pain. People will do anything to avoid facing their souls. The second point I want to make is one that was called to my attention by Colin Patterson when he asked me to speak tonight. And the phrase was mindful nationalism. Now the word nationalism is thrown around in Hawaii a lot in the movement. But anyone familiar with 20th century European history should probably cringe. The word evokes the the horror of the divisions and strife that were connected to the idea. The idea that Benedict Anderson calls imagined communities. It relates to David Gormar's predicament as well, because we have to think about if we could get nationhood, what would we be giving up in exchange? And that brings me to my third, possibly most important point, which is that reconciliation is what is about what psychologists might call development, what New Agers might call evolution. Development is simply the idea that you change over time as a person, and that continues well into adulthood. This idea has been ignored, or even come under attack within the academy because of the prevailing mode of postmodernism. Sorry to get too academic here, but it's the prevailing mode in social sciences and humanities. And postmodernism deconstructs all hierarchies. And being sequential, development implies a hierarchy. This creates what Robert Lyons called the sibling society, where equality of opportunity has transformed into equality of consciousness. And what that does is it diminishes the value of wisdom. It's my personal view that progressive communities of faith make up the bulk of those at the quote higher levels of development. Now, if that describes you, you've probably had the fortune of rarely being understood, or even being attacked by atheists on one hand, or fundamentalists on the other hand. But you're not alone. To try to succinctly explain the idea of development, I just want to explain really what drives me. And there's two things. One of them is emotional, you might say, and that is my kupuna. My kupuna signed a petition saying they did not want annexation, and my culture tells me that I should believe what they say. That's one thing. The second thing that drives me is pure and simple logic. If annexation was illegal, then the Hawaiian kingdom would remain sovereign. It's as simple as that, and nobody has disproven that. The point here is, I think, when we have the two things together, you might say, from my perspective, the now and the now. If they agree, that's a very effective way of making decisions. It's a kind of an all-inclusive logic that David Gormar might prove of. Just to conclude, you know, my students ask me if Hawaii were to be restored as a sovereign, independent country, who could stay? My answer is usually that the decision would be a decision of Hawaiians. Ironically, it's the independence movement that's been inclusive and trying to push for a multiracial citizenry. But the main point is that, in the end, we're all going to have to live together. Divisiveness and conflict might be a starting point,